Hello, I'm Yvette Torres, and welcome to another edition of The Road to Recovery. Today, we'll be talking about health reform and what it means to people with substance use and mental disorders. Joining us in our panel today are Deb Beck, President, Drug and Alcohol Service Providers Organization of Pennsylvania. Dr. Richard Frank, Professor of Health Economics, Department of Healthcare Policy, Harvard Medical School. Patrick Hendry, Senior Director of Consumer Advocacy, Mental Health America. John O'Brien, Senior Advisor for Behavioral Health Financing, Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. John, healthcare reform, why was it necessary? What benefits are we going to see out of it?
Well, Yvette, we have about 50 million individuals in this country who don't have any insurance at any given point in a year. A number of them use emergency rooms and or hospitals, and that has a very significant cost for both people who have insurance as well as employers who pay for insurance. We spend about $17.2 billion on uncompensated care for those individuals. We also know that there's a significant number of people with substance use disorders who have benefits and don't access care, but there are a significant number of individuals who can't access care because they don't have insurance benefits.
And Richard, what are the major ways the Affordable Care Act will affect the behavioral health system?
The Affordable Care Act is sort of the behavioral health aspects of the Affordable Care Act are based on sort of three principles. One is coverage and parity. Two is integration of behavioral health and healthcare. And the third is prevention. And in part because the people with behavioral health disorders have had a much higher rate of being uninsured than the rest of the population, you can expect a disproportional impact on the behavioral health community because of the coverage expansions coupled to parity.
Okay. And let's talk a little bit more about that Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, Richard. Expand a little bit particularly the types of links that are going to be made with the ACA.
The Wellstone Domenici Parity Act, which passed in 2008, went into effect in early 2010. And what it does is it really provides fairness and coverage along two dimensions. First, it requires that the standard benefits in an insurance plan be the same for the medical surgical side as it is for the behavioral health side. And so right away that means that copayments, deductibles, limits will be the same. It does a second thing, which is equally important, which is it says that if you're going to manage care, that's okay, and you can manage it differently, but you have to base it on the same clinical criteria, the same evidence, and the same logic that you use to make all your other management decisions. And in that sense, what it's doing is it's demanding fairness on the management side as well as on the benefit side, which is really revolutionary. And the Affordable Care Act adopts parity as one of its key principles that connects throughout the act. It connects in the exchanges, it connects in Medicaid expansion, it connects in the essential benefits part of the Affordable Care Act.
And Patrick, what does that mean for the consumer?
That's the big question, really. I think we're still discussing that throughout the country we know that parity is something that we've worked hard for a long, long time. And we assume that as it becomes more prevalent and really fully enacted, that that'll be a great benefit to people receiving health care. I mean, for years, we had people receiving Medicare without parity, where they paid a higher rate for mental health care than they did for their traditional health care rates. But as far as how the ACA is going to play out in terms of improving mental health care and substance abuse too. I think we're still trying to figure out where we are at the table. I just came from Louisiana yesterday, and we had a several day discussion about, you know, how do especially in the smaller states that are not so well organized, how do we get to the table to work out these details about, you know, how under integrated healthcare that mental health is not going to still be kind of a stepchild.
And Deb, for someone in the community that is working with the individuals that are need to get into recovery and that are currently in a treatment program or that are in recovery from substance use or mental disorders, what is the major point that we need to share with those individuals?
Well, I just got to start by saying one in four families has somebody with a drug and alcohol problem. And this is a progressive, always fatal illness if it goes unchecked. So trying to begin to deal with this issue in a larger way through insurance is literally life and death important. I kind of want to sidestep a bit your question because I think there are several features of the Affordable Health Care Act that hold out a lot of hope. Now, we're worried, as you are, on how do consumers access some of these things. That pathway is not entirely clear to us at this point. But pre-existing conditions, the elimination of pre-existing condition clauses has been an issue and a nettlesome one for our population. The issue of you can't get thrown off your insurance if you start to use it was something we have seen in the drug and alcohol field. Those two changes alone, I think, are extremely helpful.
John, it seems like there are a lot of moving parts to this effort. And what is SAMHSA doing to basically get the word out so that people are connected to what's going on and they really take action when they're supposed to?
Good question. We've been doing a number of things over the last 18 months, specifically around infomercials initially, around parity before the regulations came out. And then as the regulations came out, last year, we provided more detailed information, both in terms of kind of traditional ways, webinars and presentations, as well as tip sheets around parity to try to get the information out. We have 140 million people who are affected by parity. That's good. What's a little challenging is how to reach a significant portion of those individuals who, for most, parity is probably too technical of a term for them. Generally, when we talk to employers, especially large employers, they say they've done a lot of effort to try to educate folks about parity, but the fact remains is that people really don't pay attention to these benefits until they almost have to use them in most cases. So we're working with employers, we're working with our internal communication staff, external communication staff, to try to really figure out what's the best way to be able to get as much information to as many people around parity as possible.
As we continue to really unveil all of this, the ACA will increase access to behavioral health by expanding Medicaid. How will that work?
As I said, there's three large overarching principles in the Affordable Care Act. One is coverage expansion through Medicaid, which you've just mentioned. The other one is insurance market reform, which Deb referred to a little bit, but there's more to it than that. And then finally, there's delivery system and payment reform. And they all work together. They all fit together. And so, in fact, the Medicaid expansions go to cover anybody with an income below 133% of poverty line. And that coverage will include mental health benefits.
Which is approximately, what is that level?
It's like $10,000, $11,000
for an individual.
Then $28,000, $29,000 for a family of four.
Okay.
Yes. And so, in fact, for the first time, Medicaid becomes a simple means-tested program as opposed to something complicated where you have many different criteria that you have to meet. So it's just for low-income people now. And then picking up at that 133% level are subsidies to help you buy private insurance under these new organizations called health insurance exchanges, which is a way of giving individuals and small groups the same purchasing power that somebody who works, say, for the federal government or IBM would get. And that is coupled with some new regulatory rules, such as the ones that Deb mentioned around pre-existing conditions and the like.
There are lots more that we need to learn about this effort. We'll be right back.
SAMHSA is playing a huge role in helping to implement the Affordable Care Act. First of all, we're trying to make sure that behavioral health is considered in every decision that's getting made, whether it's about the exchanges or whether it's about the rules that Medicaid or Medicare put out or whether it's about the information that goes out to the public about the kinds of things that are covered or whether it's about the preventive services that will get coverage without a copay, for example, or screenings or meaningful use activities. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on, and we're trying to make sure behavioral health is at every one of those tables. So that's part of SAMHSA's role.
One of the most important things to remember is that the Affordable Care Act will offer services to a larger number of people who were previously without such services. And it will treat behavioral health service needs on par with the general health service needs. It will foster an integration of care so that we can address both the physical health as well as the behavioral health components of the whole person. It will encourage the integration and comprehensive approach to dealing with a person's behavioral health issues as well as their physical health issues.
Recovery benefits everyone.
I started my own company.
I got my dad back.
My friends believe in me.
Daddy's home.
Substance use and mental disorders can be treated. It all starts on day one. Join the Voices for Recovery. For information and treatment referral for you or someone you love, call 1-800-662-HELP. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Before, addiction and depression kept me from living my life. Now, every step I take in recovery benefits everyone. There are many options that make the road to recovery more accessible. It begins with the first step. Join the Voices for Recovery. For information and treatment referral for you or someone you love, call 1-800-662-HELP. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Like a lot of people experiencing mental illness kind of later in life, I really, my symptoms became profound in my 30s. I started having these mood swings, so I decided I should go see a doctor, and I went to my regular doctor who examined me, but he was not really familiar with psychiatrics, and he just said, you need a vacation. So I minimized the whole idea in my mind, and I continued to get worse and eventually really destroyed my company that I was working, that I owned at the time. My next step into mental health was that I ended up in a psychiatric hospital. And if we had had the type of care that we're working towards now, where all care is integrated and you walk in one door and you can see all the different types of people you need to see, I wouldn't have had to go through those extra 4 years of agony and destruction and changes to my family and all of that.
Let's talk a little bit about how many people, we had mentioned it earlier, Deb, but how many people are actually uninsured? And let's talk a little bit more about specifically in the behavioral health area.
Well, I mean, the data coming from the federal government points to 50 million people not having any kind of coverage. And people with untreated drug and alcohol problems or unaddressed mental illnesses have a hard time accessing benefits or thinking that through. You know, if I am really in the throes of an active addiction, I may not think about how to sign up for Medicaid or how to sign up for the health exchanges. So there's this big group we've got to do something with. We're really concerned about it. I think the good news is the Affordable Health Care Act includes drug and alcohol alcohol and mental health both. The problem is we're going to have to do a lot of work to help this particular population access the coverage. The coverage is there, no question, but we're dealing with a patient population that has a very difficult time getting through the hoops.
I mean, the intended goal of that is that there will be 32 million more Americans that will actually have coverage either through Medicare, Medicaid, or private insurance. So that's about two-thirds of the 50-plus million that aren't insured at this particular point in time. The best guesses, and actually they're more than just guesses, is that anywhere from 20 to 30% of those individuals of the 32 million have a mental health or substance use disorder, probably higher for those individuals that are under 133% of the federal poverty level, and we think even that may be underreported.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a recent study by the Office of the Secretary at HHS showed that John is exactly right, with about 25% of those people have a mental disorder, which means that about 20% of people with either a mental or an addictive disorder have no insurance. And so that's considerably higher than it is for the rest of the population. And so that means that the coverage expansion are going to disproportionately affect, in a positive way, those populations.
I've worked in a number of rural states in the South where the coverage typically had been that about 60 to 65% of people were either covered by Medicaid, Medicare, or VA, which left us with a substantial number of people who are not covered. And I think even as we cover these 32 million, we'll still have a very large amount of people who are not covered by any type of insurance benefit. And therefore, we're still looking either to the states to pick that up through their general revenue, or I think the new plan is hopefully that the block grants will expand to pick up some of that slack, if I'm correct.
No, that's exactly right. I mean, we know 5 years later in Massachusetts that there are a significant number of individuals, especially on the substance abuse side, we're looking on the mental health side as well, that are still unenrolled in their insurance program, in their exchanges. And there's a variety of reasons why those folks are still unenrolled. Some of it is education, information about what does insurance mean. Some of it is the way that people come on and off insurance. And so I think, the Massachusetts experience is going to be very helpful as we begin to think about the exchanges in other states.
You've mentioned exchanges, and that was just going to be my next question. We've talked about the Medicaid component of it. How do other people that do not meet that criteria, how are they going to access services? I'll start with you, John.
I think Richard had mentioned earlier that for those individuals that were greater than 133% and under 400% of the federal poverty level, we'll have the opportunity through the exchange program in states and perhaps at the national level to be able to receive an insurance benefit through a qualified health plan.
Well, let's dissect that exchange program. What is that about? How is that going to function?
Well, it's going to have a number of functions. Obviously, one of the major functions is an enrollment function, so the ability to be able to provide information to people about how to enroll insurance, provide information to people about what are the qualified health plans, to identify, recruit, screen the qualified health plans that will be offering the benefit, and again, making sure that as the qualified health plans get up and running, that they actually do what they're supposed to do.
Am I going to call a phone number? Am I going to go online? How am I going to access the exchanges?
One of the things that often happens is the patients show up in our programs, and the programs help people figure out what funding stream works or whether it's a charity case. There's a lot goes on at the front door of the programs, but I think I need to alert you, we do have some issues here. I spend a lot of time reading benefit books. Benefit books rarely reflect the Parity Act, and this is going to be a problem. We really are going to need help in order to help the consumer access the benefit they're entitled to. We have a whole lot we need to do in the consumer area and with enforcement of these statutes.
The idea behind the exchange is to sort of give to the larger U.S. population the same benefits that people who are federal employees, state employees, or work for a large employer get. And that means if you think about what those organizations do for you, they first of all, they purchase at a very low administrative cost. Second of all, they sift through the benefit books and other things, and they put fairly easy to understand tables and charts together that will help people make choices. They will also make sure that the plans to participate are qualified, have been vetted, adhere to quality standards,
sort of a good seal,
and the like. And so, exactly. And so, just like Harvard University, in my case, screens out a lot of the plans that aren't that desirable, so will the exchanges sort of help consumers get to the right kind of place and offer them choice and offer them information for making good choices.
And John, you were saying that your experience with Massachusetts has been a positive one with the exchanges, or?
Well, I think it's been a positive one with the exchanges, but we still have a number of people who are still unenrolled. And so that's a little bit disturbing given what we're trying to accomplish here in terms of getting as many people enrolled as possible. I will say you had asked the question about how are people going to know about the exchanges, enroll in the exchanges. Some of that is actually being developed and proposed over the next several months. But my guess is, a number of the medium strategies that you talked about, you know, whether it be a paper process because not everyone has computers, whether it actually be ways to enroll via web, et cetera, are all strategies that are on the table. But I think for our populations, we're going to have to be a little bit more creative than perhaps a commercial population, using providers, using consumer advocacy groups, using recovery organizations to get the word out and maybe help people understand what insurance does for them and then understand the process.
One thing I think we've done some studies over the country based on how to communicate with the consumer community, and the digital divide with the mental health consumer community is gigantic. Less than 40% of people have access to the internet, so we've got to find very creative ways to get these words out. And I think that actually will be a very solid role for consumer organizations. And we've made a lot of gains in recent years towards organizing in all of our states. So hopefully we'll be doing that. But it goes back to kind of like, you know, how do you get in touch with people that you don't know exist?
And I really want to come back to all of those consumer issues, because there's yet another layer to the ACA, which is the whole issue of electronic records that I would like to get into. We'll be right back.
For more information on National Recovery Month, to find out how to get involved, or to locate an event near you, visit the Recovery Month website at recoverymonth.gov.
When you have a drug or alcohol problem, your whole world stops making sense. You can get help for yourself or a loved one and make sense of life again. For information, treatment referral, and most importantly, help, call 1-800-662-HELP.
Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
They tell me I was there, but I don't remember. I don't know where I really was. I do not know what I had for breakfast. I do not know who won the game. I don't recognize this man.
If you or someone you know is struggling with a drug or alcohol problem, there is a solution. Recovery. Call 1-800-662-HELP for information and for hope.
Through treatment, my life's a whole lot brighter now.
Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
Thank you. Columbus House provides emergency shelter services to single men and women. We do that year-round. We're most known for that service. In terms of the SOAR project, we're targeting folks who are in our shelter and who are living outside, unfortunately living outside, but are engaged with our outreach and engagement team.
SOAR stands for SSI, SSDI, Outreach, Access, and Recovery. It's a project that started in 2005 when the federal government was holding policy academies to address homelessness across the country. And probably at least half of the states that participated in those policy academies said that one of their goals was to try and increase access to SSI or SSDI, but no one knew how to do it.
When people are living outside or in the shelter, one of the key things that they need are an income in order to be able to find their own home and live in their own home. And a lot of folks that we serve don't come in with an income, but have a significant disability that would make them eligible for Social Security.
For the clients that I work with, because of the mental health or substance abuse issues that they have, it's difficult for them to access the benefits. And sometimes they don't even know that they're eligible for benefits. So making them aware of that is a key point sometimes.
Social Security is set up that the people who want these benefits or who are going to apply for them are supposed to be able to walk in on their own or sit down at a computer on their own and do the application. This doesn't work really well for people who may have a brain disorder, who have trouble thinking or organizing their thoughts, or if they've been homeless for a long period of time, they haven't had continuity of care, so they may have been seen in an emergency room in one community and in another emergency room someplace else and in a detox in a third place, and it's all jumbled up. They don't remember where they were, they don't remember what they were treated for, they certainly don't remember the names of the doctors and so forth. So it becomes very difficult for them to actually fill out this application and do it on their own.
In the last year, we've had many of our case managers trained in the SOAR approach. And since that training, it's led to wonderful results and people who are getting benefits for the first time.
Once I was diagnosed with my disease, cirrhosis, and the doctor, first thing he said, you can't work anymore, which I was working up until that point. So that's when I was really desperately homeless.
The first time that Bill and I sat down together to fill out his application, he was denied. And after that, I did the SOAR training. So I had all this knowledge and I knew what Social Security was looking for. They're looking for his ability to function. So we were just trying to prove that his disability limited his function, which in turn limits his ability to work. And with that knowledge, we were able to get him his benefits.
Initially, the doctor told me I needed to be on a strict diet. So being able to have access to money to go to the grocery store, I can buy fresh vegetables, fruit, things like that, which is very good for me. When I could make my own meals now, it's helped immensely.
I applied for SSI initially because I just came out of the hospital due to two amputations, due to diabetes. Well, let's just say it will give me a complete total sense of independence again.
When people receive an income, they're able to move out of the shelter or out of a car and into their own home.
Before SOAR, people who were doing these applications were getting approved at about 10-15%. And after SOAR, nationally, we're achieving a 73% approval rate within 93 days. It's really fundamentally changed the way that people approach these benefits.
John, I want to go back to our previous panel dialogue on the difficulty to reach people. What are some positive best practices that we can implement? I know, Richard, you mentioned some, but let's start with John.
Well, there's a few states, and Richard mentioned New York, and maybe Richard has a little bit more details on that, but there's also Rhode Island, who actually is thinking about using its SOAR program. SOAR program as a way to be able to think about enrolling individuals. The SOAR program was very helpful in terms of getting people who qualified for Medicaid but weren't enrolled in Medicaid to actually enroll in Medicaid.
And it's a definitive program where people can call and get assistance and people will, you know, talk them through the system?
Yes, and actually even work with them face-to-face, work with them to walk through the applications, meet them even in the places where they have to complete the applications.
Very good. Any other best practices, Richard?
Well, I think the philosophy is trying to meet people where they are. And the idea is to recognize that people who are in that under 133% of the poverty line who are currently uninsured tend to be single childless adults. They tend to be very poor. Half of those people are under 50% of the poverty line. So they're extremely poor, very often homeless or have unstable housing, therefore hard to kind of track down to one place, and disproportionately don't necessarily speak English as their first language. So I think what's developed is some strategies to trying to kind of touch these people where you're likely to find them. So you go to shelters, you go to Latino community organizations, and you don't just focus on the health and the behavioral health sectors, but you reach out more broadly to the larger social service sector.
John, you mentioned using SOAR in Rhode Island. I mean, it's been such a successful program. I would think there'd be a really wider conversation about using it nationwide because it's
That's one of the things we are looking at. In addition, not only just those individuals that are below 133% of the federal poverty level, but for those individuals between 133 and 400, you've got a lot of youth in there that are not insured. And for the most part, the way that youth communicate these days is through PDAs and other devices. And so, again, thinking about strategies by which for those youth that have PDAs that might have a mental health or substance use condition to try to reach out to them around, you know, the importance of insurance. Because I can certainly remember when I was 21 or 22 and somebody wanted to take money out of my paycheck for insurance, I thought twice about it. But the fact remains is that, you know, I think we're going to have to do a little bit of a business case for those individuals. And as Richard said, meet them where they're at, which is generally on their PDA.
Well, if I may take it a step further, in our state, we're in the process of going through comprehensive training. The front door, again, is often the outpatient and residential treatment programs. The treatment programs don't understand the relationship between the state law, the Parity Act, and the Affordable Health Care Act. So that's what we're doing, is we're going door to door and providing comprehensive training. And I think all states need to do that. There's an awful lot of misinformation out there. Even the insurers themselves are confused and may misrepresent inadvertently what the benefit is. I can't tell you how important this is. It's actually somewhat simpler than one might imagine. People do show up in time of crisis in all of these places. And if our front doors are not thoroughly trained in the interrelationship between all of those laws, it's not going to work. We've got to do this.
And it's particularly important for the providers to take that role.
Absolutely.
John, I want to come back because we mentioned during break the whole intersect between the publicly funded programs, the privately funded behavioral health programs, and how those will interact with the mainframe healthcare system. How is that going to happen? Are they going to survive that transition? How is that going to work?
Well, I think that the integration of primary care and behavioral health is critical. We know that there are a significant number of individuals in our healthcare system that have a mental health or substance use disorder. And as Deb said, in some cases it's 25%, one out of four. A lot of people that have a mental health and substance use condition have another condition, another health condition, or a chronic health condition that they need not only just primary care, but also specialty health care. Over the last several years, SAMHSA has embarked on a primary care behavioral health integration project. Prior to the Affordable Care Act being in place, if you look at a number of provisions in the Affordable Care Act, there's a variety of strategies, including incentives for states as well as providers, to begin to really be serious about good strategies that will be successful in the integration.
And similarly, there's a whole notion that we started to talk about, which is the electronic health records. Richard, I want you to address that. Is that primarily being done not only because the technology is there, but do we stand to save a substantial amount if people begin to allow their records to be exchanged?
Well, there's a couple of motivations for doing that. First of all, coordinating care, preventing bad medication interactions, preventing errors, has been very tightly linked to the ability to sort of organize information and communicate it quickly. And so really that is sort of, I think, the jumping off point for the electronic medical record. The fact that it might also save money by avoiding duplication, et cetera, is, I think, also hoped for, and there's sort of some suggestions that that might occur. But even if it didn't save money, it's an important thing to do based on quality, on preventing mortality, preventing morbidity. And so I think it's important for that reason. The federal government started off by focusing really on doctors and acute care hospitals. And then there's a report to Congress due very soon that will assess what needs to be done to bring long-term care providers, home health agencies, behavioral health providers into that type of program. And so really it's being done in multiple waves just out of just the size of the problem. And so there's a report that's coming out pretty soon from the Office of the Secretary of HHS setting out the steps that you need to take to sort of continue to expand the electronic medical record.
And Patrick and Deb, for the consumer, this is going to mean what?
Well, we're worried in the drug and alcohol side and grateful for the efforts going on between SAMHSA, Legal Action Center. We've got a patient population that doesn't want somebody to know they're using an illicit drug. We're kind of grateful that this is moving slowly with careful consideration of each wave. Our folks sometimes don't come to help because they're afraid somebody will find out they have a problem. So this has to be handled with extraordinary sensitivity.
It's the same thing with the mental health consumer community. There's actually a large division because some people really do see the benefit of having, a single healthcare record that contains all the needed information. But there's also a lot of history behind the mental health consumer movement that has left a lot of people very bitter and not trusting of the system. So we actually, we have many different names that we call ourselves as people who receive mental health services. Some of us choose to call ourselves consumers of mental health services. Some call themselves survivors, and generally when they use the word survivor, they don't mean surviving their mental illness. Mm. They mean surviving the mental health system. Mm. So when you have that kind of division, it definitely sets up a problem for getting buy-in to the idea that there's going to be this central record. The other area where it really is going to be a big effect is among returning vets, and National Guard and Reserve and on-duty military people, because they're so concerned, particularly the people who are still on duty, that if they go someplace for assistance, there's going to be this record there that's going to ruin their career. And so the anonymity part of it is extremely important to them.
So we have to look for safeguards, and we also have to look for a lot of public education of the potential patients as they're going into the system. And we'll be talking a little bit about that when we come back.
There are 43 states have an insurance law, and there's a need for someone in each state to provide training on the state law, how it relates to the Parity Act, and then how it relates to all of the phases and phasing in of the Affordable and Accountable Care Act. The good news is drug and alcohol is included in the Affordable Health Care Act and Parity. One of the things we're still struggling with, though, is how to access the benefit. And we've really got to work out a pathway for families. It's just imperative that this be dealt with in an urgent fashion. Or the outcomes are death, people end up in jail, and emergency room admissions go way up. It is imperative that the new Health Care Reform Act have a pathway that is workable for this particular illness.
What is the cost of drug and alcohol addiction?
I lost my job.
I lost my home.
I lost my health.
I lost my self-respect.
I lost my freedom.
If you have a drug or alcohol problem, remember, treatment is effective and recovery is possible. For information on drug and alcohol treatment referral for you or someone you know, call 1-800-662-HELP and see what you could save.
I got my life back.
I had no idea it was going to be so hard. I didn't know what to expect. You hear the stories, but I never took any of it seriously until I found myself here. And then I realized I was going to have to work hard for my recovery.
If you or someone you know has a drug or alcohol problem, you are not alone. Call 1-800-662-HELP.
Recovery was the hardest job I ever had, and the most important.
Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
The mission of the National Council for Community Behavioral Health Care is to, through our membership, to reach out to individuals who may not have access to behavioral health services or may not know that those services are available to them. And Mental Health First Aid is a way that we can teach the general public about mental illness and how they can help. What's the difference between, say, just nervousness or normal anxiety and something that might rise to the level of disorder? Mental Health First Aid is a program for the general public. For people who maybe could know nothing about mental illness.
We have signs everywhere about how to recognize if someone's having a stroke.
Any questions about non-suicidal self-injury, this behavior, before we move on to talk about anxiety disorders?
But I've never heard anyone come out and say, these are things to recognize that someone in your family might be mentally ill. And even further, what to do about it.
Much like regular first aid, it teaches people to recognize signs and symptoms, de-escalate crisis, and if appropriate, provide referral to services.
Many groups could benefit from mental health first aid training.
What does anxiety look and feel like?
We learned 4 or 5 different questions to ask people to determine if they were suicidal or not. And then we role played and gave some examples of good things to say and bad things to say.
Like in CPR, you have ABC, airway, breathing, circulation. In mental health first aid, you have ALGI, assess for risk of suicide or harm, listen non-judgmentally, give reassurance and information, encourage appropriate professional help, and encourage self-help and other support strategies. Focus on ways to stop the distress, not the behavior.
You can understand it in layman's terms. The general public can understand it.
We teach that mental illness is just like physical illness. It's just like diabetes, it's just like heart disease, in that it's disabling, it's real, but it's also treatable.
The more people who know where referral sources are, the more that they will refer. And quite often people hesitate because they don't know what to do, even if they identify a problem.
When I heard that there was a concrete way that I could learn how to react, that was very appealing to me.
Let the person know that you're available to talk when they're ready. Mental health first aid does not teach people how to diagnose mental illness. It does not teach people how to treat mental illness. It's a first aid course. Remember, we talked about substance use disorders co-occurring with other mental forms of mental illness. Someone may self-medicate if they're depressed or self-medicate if they're anxious. Substance use disorders are in fact disorders. They aren't just bad behavior or weak will.
It is a mental health issue. So no matter what the drug of choice is, it is still a problem. And we have to get people to recognize that it's still a mental health problem that can be addressed and can be treated.
Here's the statement. Self-harm is a failed suicide attempt. See, lots of fiction, lots of fiction. Why is that? Why do you think that's the case, Nicole?
If we can get on that front edge, I believe that we can reduce the total costs in healthcare.
John, how does ACA shift its focus into prevention and wellness, and what is that going to mean?
The prevention and wellness is prominently highlighted throughout the Affordable Care Act. I think the Secretary talks about shifting the conversation around sicker people to healthier people. There are a number of provisions that I think are worth talking about. Obviously, the establishment of the National Prevention Council
which was established, I believe, at the beginning of this year, has a number of people on it that are actually knowledgeable about substance abuse and mental health. There's the Prevention and Public Health Trust Fund, which was started in 2010 at $500 million last year. That grows over the next couple of years to, I believe, $2 billion. Then most recently, the Center for Disease Control has just released their community transformation grants that have a fairly significant focus, obviously on prevention, but also prevention of substance use, alcohol use, and tobacco use.
Very good. And Patrick, what does that mean for the behavioral health care? How do we do prevention in the context of public health within the behavioral health care system?
And when we talk about prevention and behavioral health, it's almost like we're talking about a different thing to a large degree, because we're certainly not talking about preventing people from having an illness. What we're talking about is preventing people going into crisis generally and into a deeper end of services. So it's really, really critical that we put a lot of emphasis on prevention and recovery resiliency-based programs in mental health, because the difference in cost and services between somebody coming into a system and receiving the aid they need at the beginning that will help keep them out of the hospitals and the crisis units can be as high as 10 to 1. I mean, in some states, the cost of keeping a person in a state psychiatric hospital for a year is $120,000, whereas the cost for keeping somebody in the next highest level of service, which is generally considered to be our sort of community treatment teams, ACT teams, is about $12,000. So it's 10 to 1. So we've seen the exact opposite happening with all the cuts going on the state levels, because they're cutting the front end first. It's easier to cut these recovery-based programs because they know they need to keep those hospital beds. The problem is every time they do that, they need to keep more hospital beds.
Can I jump in?
Sure.
There?
I was just going to go to you to tell us, you know, because part of the act talks about no cost sharing, and I'm hearing all these ka-ching, ka-ching, ka-chings appearing.
Well, let me just make a couple points that build on Patrick's point, which is, you know, I think the science, we're at a point right now where the science has taken a major leap. And so recently, the Institute of Medicine has come out with several reports on preventing behavioral health problems in children and adults. The Science Institute, the NIMH, and NIDA and NIAAA all have early intervention studies going on that are extraordinarily promising. And I think that actually the science should make us a little bit more optimistic about our ability to actually prevent disorders. So, for example, the Affordable Care Act has a nurse home visitation program as part of it. And that's been studied for 30 years, and the first randomized trial was 33 years ago, and it showed that you could actually prevent lots of bad things from happening to children as they grew when they live in at-risk households. And similarly, if you treat mothers' depression, mothers of young children, you do things to prevent both substance use disorders from developing, but also a variety of behavioral problems and early schooling. And so I think there's a lot of promise here. And I think that promise is what prompted the act to put in the provisions to make it really easy to access those types of services.
Also, the untreated alcohol and drug problems drive medical costs in unwanted ways. They just drive up all kinds of healthcare costs. This illness is so co-occurring with a whole host of very expensive medical conditions. So once you develop a plan where there is this benchmark coverage in every area of insurance, whether it's Medicaid, the exchanges, the group health plans, you're raising the possibility of cutting down on an enormous amount of unwanted healthcare spending. Just think one fetal alcohol syndrome birth that was preventable. The ACOA is also sprinkled with screening. early screening. And that's how we get out the population who is currently uninsured, is to do the early screening and intervention, catch people's addiction earlier in the disease, and then the benchmark plans provide for the treatment of it. We should be, if we did this thoroughly, able to cut down on other medical spending. That's major prevention stuff in my book.
That's just true also for mental health. Early screening is the best tool we have really for prevention, I think, in terms, and some of the things that we were mentioning.
John?
I think screening is incredibly important. However, I think trying to get primary care professionals to do screening in a way that really allows them to identify substance use or mental health condition is critically important. I'll just tell you this personal story, and that is I went in for my primary care visit. The nurse came in, did a screening, asked me about drug use, and I asked her how many people in the 10 years that she had been there had actually said yes, and she said one. And she works for a very, very large healthcare organization.
It's certainly something that you know will need further study and implementation actually, and for people to actually do it. I know that we have ESPRT, which does a great job of screening patients at every sector of the healthcare system for mental health and for addiction treatment. There's also another program that we have, which is the Community Transformation Grant. John, do you want to talk a little bit about that and what they will do?
Sure. And they were released in May of this year. They are for states and local communities. Their primary focus, obviously, is on prevention. Prevention of a variety of activities. One of those activities is around prevention of focus on emotional health. Within the emotional health category, there are a number of activities that are specifically focused on preventing alcohol use, substance use, and to promote emotional wellness.
So will SAMHSA continue to do programs that will help communities integrate into this new ACA framework?
Yes. As a matter of fact, we provided, as soon as they came out, information to our stakeholders that are representative of states and local communities in order for them to take advantage of those grant programs.
And just so that we touch base, let's review some of the places where individuals can go and get help, because there's so many pieces to this. Richard, you were talking about the Office of National Coordinator.
Yes. Inside of Department of Health and Human Services, there's an office that is in charge of all the health information technology. And they give grants to states, and they have worked with individual providers to sort of really bolster the expansion and the responsible use of health information technology. And they're very sensitive to the issues of behavioral health consumers that were brought up. And so it is really that office, the Office of National Coordinator for Health Information Technology, where people should contact with these issues.
But John, there's also other offices that provide the consumer with information as to how to reach the exchanges, talk about the health homes, talk about all of the other components, correct?
Yes. Out of the Office of the Secretary, out of HHS, there is a website, a very good website, around the Affordable Care Act. And it's incredibly user-friendly, provides information about the act. It's also being populated now with information that is state-specific about what's being covered and insurance companies within those states. It's a rolling implementation so that as the secretary gets additional information, that information is put into that website. Incredibly interactive. SAMHSA also has a website on health reform, and within that website, we talk about parity, we talk about the health homes, we talk about the grant opportunities that I just talked about, and a variety of other issues as well.
Final thoughts, Deb, in terms of what consumers need to know and what they need to do?
Well, the opportunity here is huge, but the challenge is, how do we set it up so the law is enforceable? Again, I'm looking at benefit books that don't reflect the Parity Act yet, and the ACA is coming coming down the pike soon. So we have to find some way to catch all of this and put it down where the consumer opens a benefit book, and there it is.
Patrick.
Well, and I think it actually even goes beyond that. I mean, I think in the substance abuse community, but also in the mental health community, word of mouth is probably one of the best ways we have of getting information out. Again, because we have these problems of, for instance, I worked in Florida for a number of years, and we knew that we only served about 49% of the people who really needed our services in the state, and the rest were untreated completely. So how did we have access to even get a book to them? Mm-hmm. You know, so we've got a long way to go to really find a way to communicate with the people who need it.
Richard, final thoughts.
I think this is a historic opportunity. I think that 10 years from now, when we look back, we'll say that this was bigger, particularly for the substance use disorder community, than the creation of Medicare and Medicaid. That this is really huge. And I know it's a well-worn cliche at this point, but it really is a game changer.
And I want to thank you for being here. I want to remind our audience that National Recovery Month is every September. Our information package this year is on healthcare reform issues, so I hope that the leaders in communities take a look at it and organize events and activities around getting information out to the public about the new healthcare reform and the ACA. Thank you for being here.
For a copy of this program or other programs in the Road to Recovery series, call SAMHSA at 1-800-662-HELP or order online at recoverymonth.gov and click Multimedia. Every September, National Recovery Month provides an opportunity for communities like yours to raise awareness of substance use and mental health problems, to highlight the effectiveness of treatment and that people can and do recover. In order to help you plan events and activities in commemoration of this year's Recovery Month observance, the free Recovery Month kit offers ideas, materials, and tools for planning, organizing, and realizing an event or outreach campaign that matches your goals and resources. To obtain your copy of this year's Recovery Month kit and gain access to other free publications and materials related to recovery issues, visit the Recovery Month website at www.recoverymonth.gov or call 1-800-662-HELP.